secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Reading from Acts. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership in possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 133. Let's read responsibly by half verse. Oh, how good and pleasant it is
when the brethren live together in unity.
It is like fine oil upon the head
that runs down upon the beard.
Upon the beard of Aaron.
Runs down along the collar of his throat.
It is like the dew of Hermon
that falls on the hills of Zion.
For there the Lord has ordained a blessing,
life forevermore.
A reading from 1 John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands. Concerning the word of life, this life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declared to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say they have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie, and we not do what is true. But if we walk in the light He himself is in the light. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I write these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Have any of you ever heard of Holy Humor Sunday?
No.
Or the Sunday of Hilarity?
No.
It's a thing. It really is. It's a thing, and it's today. It is today, the second Sunday after Easter, which is an old, old tradition of having Humor Sunday. It's also called Bright Sunday. Bright Sunday. And it comes from the early Christians who believed that God played a joke on the devil by raising Jesus from the dead. Or, how is it possible, or a joke on us, how is it possible that God raised someone from the dead? Ha ha ha, that's not possible. Well, it is, jokes on us. And so, Holy Humor Sunday was born, and this is the day for that. In Latin, it is Risus Pascalis, the Easter laugh. The Easter laugh. And so in some churches, parishioners and pastors, they would play practical jokes on each other, and they would drench each other with water and sing and dance, and it was a time for clergy and people to tell jokes and just have a rip-roaring time, which sounds great to me. So maybe next year, I'll prepare you, and we can have a Holy Humor Sunday. Well, yesterday, I traveled to North Georgia to officiate a funeral out in the country. Some of you all know Nancy Rice, who was a parishioner here for many years. She was a senior warden and a treasurer. Well, she moved away with her husband to East Tennessee. But in the fall, her sister passed. And so we had organized for me to go yesterday to North Georgia to find their family plot. Y'all know about family plots. They can be really happening everywhere. But I found it, no problems. And we did the search. So I'm a little tired looking today. It might be because I was driving a lot yesterday and a lot of pollen. But there's a story about a bagpiper who was asked by the funeral home to play the pipes at a funeral. And it was the funeral of a homeless man who had no friends and no family. And it was going to be at a country cemetery out in the boondocks. Now, the bagpiper did not know the area. And so when he got lost, no big surprise. But he also didn't want to ask anybody how to get there, because he was a very proud man. I'm not saying anything. She said it was because he was a man. I'm like, oh. Hey, we all have Google Maps nowadays anyway, right? But this is, I guess this is an old story. Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, he was hourly. He gets there, and the hearse is gone, the funeral director is gone, all there is the workers. And they were sitting down and eating their lunch. And so he got there, and he felt really bad. He apologized for being late. And he went to the side of the grave, and he looked down, and he saw that it was already in place, and that the top of the vault lid was already there. And so, not knowing what else to do, he starts to play. And the workers, they put down their lunches, and they stand up, and they listen as this bagpiper soulfully plays Amazing Grace, plays his heart out, and the workers, they weep. They weep, tears coming down their face, you know, oh, just so beautiful. And when the bagpiper finishes, he packs up the pipes, and he starts for the car. Though his head hung low, his heart was full. And as he opens the door to the car, he hears one of the workers say, "You know, I've never seen anything like that. And I've been putting in septic tanks for 10 years." He is risen, and he celebrate Easter, not just one Sunday, but seven. There we go, 50 days, 50 days of Easter. And so in the next 7 weeks, we're going to be, well, 6 weeks, we're going to be talking about resurrection and talking about what does that mean and what does that mean to us. And so this week we have an appearance of Jesus to his disciples. Next week also the walk to Emmaus. And so you'll see the season of Easter is a time of resurrection power. Now, the seasons change. Things up here at the altar area change too. And so, now, of course, last week, you already saw this if you were here last week. But what is different up here now? What do y'all notice, especially youngins? Do you notice anything different?
That there's no white branches up there anymore.
The branches are gone. They were for Lent, right? So instead, we now have flowers. Yes, the branches are gone. It's good. Yeah. What else is different?
It's crossed.
Yeah. What about the cross?
White.
It's got the white cloth. Yeah, white cloth. Which is actually all of everything's white.
Yes.
We got white fabrics up here now. From on the frontal and on the lectern and over there and the chasuble. And the white stands for glory and resurrection, power and purity and joy. And it is part of the Easter season. So that's when we went from purple, and then we went red for Palm Sunday, and Maundy Thursday, black for Good Friday, and now Easter joy. So that's where we get the white. What else were you pointing to?
The candle.
The candle. That's right. This candle is called the Paschal candle. And we light it all through the season of Easter, and it represents the light of God. On Saturday night before Easter, it's actually the Easter Vigil. Actually, sundown is the beginning of Easter. A lot of Episcopal churches will have the vigil, the Easter vigil, and will light brand new candle. We use slate. Is that right? Am I getting the right?
Flint steel.
And we light a new candle. And new candle, a new light. So this represents the light of God and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Okay? And this one actually has some symbols in the front. Does anybody know what these symbols are?
Alpha and Omega.
The Alpha and the Omega, that's right. Jesus is the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. That's right.
Easter.
Easter, yes, it means Easter. And it means Passover, Pascha, Passover, Christian Passover, okay? Because the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, is our Passover himself. You remember the story of the Exodus. You know, the Israelites were slaves in Egypt for 500 years under Pharaoh. And they cried out to God to be set free. And the Lord sends them Moses. And then there's the 10 plagues. And the last plague is the death of the firstborn. And so it's a frightening thing. You know, what are we going to do? And the Lord says, well, take a lamb and sacrifice the lamb and put the blood of that lamb on the door, the lintels above the door, and so that when it comes time, the angel of death comes and will pass over your house. Well, Jesus is our Passover lamb, the eternal Passover lamb, whose blood is on our door, you know, and because of him, death passes over us as well. Hence, resurrection life has his life now within us. So the Paschal candle, the Paschal mystery, the Passover mystery, all of that. Another thing I wanted to point out to you is when we break the bread, in a little while, in the communion, post-communion prayer, we're going to have the fraction. And so the priest will lift up the bread and break it in half. Or in our case, we have a big wafer and a half. And that is a symbol of Christ's body being broken. Himself, Jesus being broken, but not just him being broken, also the power of death. And the power of sin, and the power of the devil, and all of that being visually broken for us. Years ago, I saw a video kind of description of the communion service of the Eucharist. And when that part happened, and the breaking of the bread, it was chains being pulled apart and being broken. And the chains of those things upon us were now broken as well in Christ. So I love that image. It really spoke to me. And this casual. It's a poncho, you know. The poncho of Jesus. And whoever is wearing it is the celebrant of the day. It's the person who is presiding over a remembrance of the Last Supper when Jesus sat with his disciples and said, "This is my bread, this is my body, and this is my blood," to the disciples. So whether it's me or the bishop or some other clergy person wearing it, that's what the chasuble means. It's Latin for little house. Isn't that great? I'm in the little house. Casita. I want to say it in Spanish so bad, but just not good. Thank you for clapping. Yes. Yeah. So today is also Thomas Sunday. St. Thomas. Doubting Thomas. Poor Thomas. He gets a bad rap, really. Because he wasn't there. He wasn't there. He was out. Who knows? Maybe he couldn't find parking. I don't know. He wasn't there on that Sunday morning when Jesus appeared to the 12. And so the very next week, at the same time, they were gathered again in the upper room. This time, Thomas is present, and Jesus appears to them. And we see something about what does resurrection bodies mean. What does that mean? Because Jesus is in the room. He comes through the locked doors. He walks through walls. What is that, you know? But yet, he also had a physical body that you can touch. So the resurrection body is beyond us, right? It's in the fourth dimension. We don't know exactly what that will look like. We too are raised, but that gives us a little bit of a clue. And so he appears to Thomas, and here's my hands, here's my side, let's do it. And what is Thomas's reaction?
My Lord, my God,
right? So much for being a doubter, right? You know, he's the first one to call Jesus God, divine. So, you know, he's not doubting Thomas. He's believing Thomas, you know. Yeah. Well, let's see. So Thomas got his visual aid. You know, his visual aids help us. But Jesus said, "Blessed are you who believe, but yet not, have not seen." And unless any of us have seen the resurrected Christ, then we fall into that category of being the blessed ones who believe without being seen. So well done, blessed are you. Also, what does Jesus say to the disciples? The doors locked for fear of the Jews. They're quivering in their, you know, their shoes. They're terrified. Of course they are. But what does he say to them? Does he say, "Get with it, people. What's your problem? Don't you know you don't need to fear?" And he doesn't say that at all. He doesn't condemn them. He says, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." What a gift to Thomas and to all of them. They were ashamed for their failures, which they had just committed, you know, betraying Jesus, leaving him, not being at the cross. Some of their disciples were, the women were, but not the men. And they were embarrassed by this, I'm sure, and ashamed, but he doesn't say condemn them at all. He says, "Peace be with you." And that's true for us, too, because we, too, live in fear. Because we fear death. That's what all fear is rooted in, is our own fear of dying. But Jesus is now in the resurrection taking care of that fear. He has been raised, and we will too, so we need not fear anymore. It takes some convincing, though, doesn't it? You know, peace be with you. You know, peace be with you. You don't need to fear. You're not going to ultimately die forever and ever. He's going to raise you. You have his eternal life now. Be not afraid. Peace be with you. And so that is the word for you today. That in your own fears, this Easter season, don't be afraid. in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. According to the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest, especially Barbara Graves, Johnny, Sandy, Jackie Kelly. Let light
like perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, especially on the back of the board. For members of the congregation, Ellen, Linda, Greg, Jean. Friends and loved ones, Jessica, Avery, Johnny, James, Janet, Sandy, Ronnie, Allison, Haley, Chris, Fulton, Emily, Tasha, Karen, Lisa, Kim, Sarah, Nancy, Tina, Jess, Cole, and those who you would like to name silently or aloud. Those in long-term care,
Marlene, Kathy,
our first responders and those in military service and their families, especially
Trevor, Mallory, Sean, Dalton.
For those having birthdays this month,
Brenda, Maya, Tiffany, Annalise, Jean.
We pray for our outreach partners, Friars Dowdy Elementary, Joseph Storehouse, and Compassionate Hands, and the people they serve. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Bartholomew's of Nashville.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith
church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
You may be seated. And if there's anyone who would like to receive the anointing with oil and laying on of hands for healing, you may now come forward.
Stand and greet one another in the name of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Consume the bread and receive from the common cup, or you can leave it. to you. If you're really good, you can catch it like that, or otherwise it'll go right in your hand, which is fine too. Or you can cross your arms and then the chalice will pass you by. Or if you don't want to receive communion today, for whatever reason, you'd like to receive a prayer, a blessing, you can come forward and just put your arms like this and I'll say a prayer, a blessing upon you. And so, with that, all walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Lift up your
hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our souls are so very sore.
brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.